Hello, all students of literature. Today we're talking about a story by Sherman Alexie. It is called What You Pawn, I Will Redeem. So let's get to it. This was written in 2003, and it is the tale, the fictional tale, of a Native American man who is homeless and living in Seattle. He finds his grandmother's regalia in a pawn shop. At least he believes it's his grandmother's regalia. And I think that it is. I'll get into why in just a little bit. And the pawn shop owner says, "Hey, wish I could just give it to you, but I paid $1,000 for this. So if you, I'll give you 24 hours, and if you can produce $999, then you can have it. You can buy it off of me." And so what begins from there is a quest story. Our main character, who is named Jackson Jackson, is on the search, on the hunt for $1,000. So that's an overview of the story, but let's get into the little details, the fascinating little bits of text that are worth analyzing. Jackson Jackson, as our narrator, does give us a few clues as to how he has arrived in this position of homelessness, and more so about how he has disconnected himself from loved ones. He does say a few things. Now, there's humor sprinkled throughout, even though there's a lot of sadness within this text. And one of those humorous places happens here when he says, "Flunked out after two semesters of college, worked various blue and bluer collar jobs, married two or three times, fathered two or three kids." So there's something that's kind of amusing that he can't quite remember if he was married twice or three times, and he's not really sure how many kids he has. So he is a character that will use humor. He is a character that we don't know how reliable he is all of the time with some of the concepts and the memories that he's offering to us. But all in all, he is, I think, a very likable narrator. He emphasizes several times his peaceable nature, talking about how, although he might get very drunk in various parts of this story, he is not aggressive towards others. In fact, he is often throughout the story giving towards others, sharing what little wealth or currency he happens to stumble upon. So in addition to the humor, he's also talking about how he has departed from people and in some ways departed from his own sanity little by little, piece by piece, that he is slowly disappearing, that he doesn't just up and disappear. But the answer to the question why did he become homeless? Why did he allow his life to fall apart? Why has he become a raging alcoholic? That is left open to our interpretation. And I think that we can kind of see from the choices that our character is making, we get to sort of understand him. So at the beginning of the story, Jackson Jackson has friends, or as he calls him, teammates. He has Rose and he has Junior. They might be from different tribes, but as we see at the very beginning, they seem like very tight-knit friends. However, that changes very quickly. In the opening scenes, this team, Junior, Rose, and our narrator, Jackson Jackson, they go into a pawn store that they've never seen before. And Jackson says that, "Hey, I'm familiar with pawn stores and I've never seen this shop before." Now, I didn't ever think about this until I've read this. I've read it like four times now. And on the fourth reading, it dawned on me that there might be something a little bit magical about the pawn shop, because it appears in the story kind of by surprise. And then at the end of the story, he's searching for the pawn shop and he can't find it. And he says, I swear it was at a different place. Now, again, this could simply be because Jackson might be considered an unreliable narrator because he's intoxicated much of the time. And he has, you know, maybe some memory issues, maybe some directional issues. So kind of like in the story we talked about before, Uncle Ben's Choice, it might just be, you know, kind of confusion that explains why the pawn shop is here in one scene, and then at the end of the story, it seems to be in another place. But I've read so many fantasy stories that I can't help but thinking, like, ooh, maybe there is something like a little bit of magical that this pawn shop has arrived basically to offer kind of a magical-like quest to say, hey, if you do these things, you will get your grandmother's regalia that has been missing because it was stolen 50 years ago. There's something very, very fantastical about that, you know, the basic premise of this quest story. So whether it's real or fantastical, he does go into the pawn shop and he goes in with his teammates. And at first, Jackson Jackson is saying, hey, this is my grandmother's regalia. The pawn shop owner says, like, how do you know it is? And he says, Jackson Jackson says, that my family may, they include little flaws. And so you might find this, a little bead, a yellow bead sewn into the work. So they look at the regalia and sure enough, they find that yellow bead. What follows then is a challenge. The pawn shop owner says, hey, I'll sell this to you for $999. That way I lose a dollar, that's fair. And he accepts that challenge. Jackson Jackson could, in theory, call the police and say, hey, authorities, come and take care of this. This is my grand, I have proof. I found the bead and this is my grandmother's and this belongs to my family. It's stolen goods, it should be mine. But he is sympathetic to the pawn shop owner, feeling like the pawn shop owner didn't know it was stolen, and so he accepts this challenge, and the pawn shop owner gives him a little bit of money. The pawn shop owner slaps down a $20 bill and says, hey, you're on your way, you got 24 hours, come back with $999 and your grandmother's regalia is yours. And sometimes I talk with students and they are disappointed in what he does with the money, because he takes the $20 and he buys alcohol and they get plastered. He and his teammates get very drunk. Junior vomits on himself and stays unconscious for a long time. Rose falls asleep, gets up, disappears, and basically abandons the quest. He never sees her again, and eventually Junior is still asleep and he goes back and takes off Junior's socks and shoes to discover a dollar and a couple quarters. And so he steals from Junior. So he's doing things that upon first reading it, I'm very critical of. When I read it the first time, I'm thinking like, oh, Jackson, Jackson, this is why you're homeless and this is why, you know, you're not going to pull yourself up by your bootstraps and get out of the gutter. Now when I'm reading it, I'm reading it in a wiser and much more compassionate way, because for one, I'm reading it and wondering like, yeah, why doesn't the pawn shop owner just give him, if he found the bead, that seems like it's evidence that yes, it's stolen, this belongs to his family, he should hand it over. So I'm much more critical now of the pawn shop owner than I was the first time I read it. And if you have read the story once or a couple times, I would love to know your thoughts on the pawn shop's owner at the beginning. Now that said, I do think the pawn shop owner, I kind of see him again as like a mystical figure almost. So when I read it now, even though I think like, hey, why didn't he give him the regalia to begin with? I'm thinking that he wants to send Jackson Jackson on this sort of vision quest. And when Jackson goes out into the world with the $20, yes, he does get plastered. He does get drunk a few times. but he is finding different opportunities to connect with others and to listen to their story and to ask for help and to receive help. And members of the community, whether they are fellow homeless people or fellow Native Americans or police officers or Mary, the Korean American woman who runs the store, or even kind of the waitress, he's giving these people opportunity to help out along the way. And we are really seeing something that is both, in a sense, a warm, loving, tight-knit community, but also a community that disperses easily, in particular the Native American characters that just kind of leave and they might drown, they might die of exposure, they might never be heard from again. So those characters are kind of coming and going. the other community characters that are connected with either the society, like the cop, who's been around a long time, or the worker characters, the waitress and the shop owner characters, those characters are kind of more static, that they are very, I think, sincere in their compassion for Jackson Jackson, but also it feels like they don't have any real way of helping out Jackson. So, if you were going to write an essay about What You Pawn, I Will Redeem, what would you write about? Obviously, there's a lot of different choices, and maybe if you are writing about it, your instructor has already said, hey, you're gonna write about this. But if you have a little bit of freedom, I would suggest looking at the choices that Jackson Jackson makes in this. Because I think he is making choices that are both self-destructive and yet at the same time, compassionate. When you look at the choices that Jackson Jackson makes, he seems to keep going back and forth, bouncing back and forth between self-destructive actions, especially when he is indulging in alcohol, and actions of compassion and understanding. So why does he do these things? Why does he do both of these things? Why is he so self-destructive? His grandmother died of cancer, but before the cancer took her life, she also had an accident where, you know, involving a motorcycle, and also she had her regalia stolen from her. Some people think that it was the accident that caused the cancers that led to her death. Jackson Jackson wonders if it was something that had to do with the regalia, with her culture basically, being stolen from her that caused the cancer. And I think her death creates this emotional cancer for him, that maybe he's being self-destructive. Perhaps part of him feels that oblivion is the only way that he's going to connect with his long-lost loved ones. At the same time, while going on this quest and meeting people and listening to them and sometimes helping them out or sometimes being generous, by doing that, he's remembering stories about his grandmother and his grandfather. And by the end, when the pawn shop owner does what I think is the right thing by giving the regalia to him and he's dancing, he feels like he's with his grandmother, and then he basically imagines that he is his grandmother dancing in the streets of Seattle, and the whole city has stopped to watch him. So again, I think that he's being self-destructive because he wants to return or be reunited with his dead relatives, in particular his grandmother. But he's also living, he's also doing these positive things because that's also a way to find and connect, I think in a more positive and healthy way, to find and connect with his grandmother and with his ancestral roots. And essentially with himself, with his own identity. So those are just a few thoughts about the story, What You Pawn, I Will Redeem. If you've read this story, I would love to know your thoughts and interpretations on it. So feel free to leave a comment, or if you've got your own video, leave a link down below, and I'd love to watch it. That's it for now. Happy reading, and I'll talk to you soon.